Okay, I think we're ready to start. We have pretty much everyone on the in the room right now. So thank you all for being here and welcome to this Referral Candidate Pricing webinar. It's great to be here with all of you. I appreciate you being here. Today, we're gonna be talking about e-commerce pricing and more specifically, what are the different pricing strategies that you can follow on your online store to get ahead from your competition. I have an expert in this area with me today, who I'll introduce in a minute. But if this is your first time in a Referral Candidate webinar, let me introduce myself. So my name is Raul. I'm the partner manager here at Referral Candidate, and I'll be your webinar host. That means that I will be taking your questions. I'll make sure that everyone in this webinar gets to ask a question to our expert, who I'll introduce in a minute. So anytime you have a question about a specific topic that we'll discuss, and feel free to type it in the chat box, and we'll make sure to stop several times. Also, at the end, we'll leave a few minutes to answer any pending questions. If you don't know about Referral Candidate, Referral Candidate is an app that allows you to quickly set up and run a referral program on your online store. We'll give more information about this at the end of the webinar. And let me introduce the expert. With me today is Borg Tanir, who's the CEO of Pricing and is an expert in e-commerce pricing. And he has a very detailed presentation prepared for us today. So there's a lot to learn from him today. So what I'm gonna do now is to thank Borg for being here. It's a pleasure to have you, Borg.
Thank you. Thank you, Raul. It's also a pleasure for me to, you know, be with you.
Awesome. And also for you guys, if you don't know about pricing is a competitor price tracking software for e-commerce companies of all sizes from all around the world. And again, we'll have some more information about this at the end of the webinar for all of you. I also wanted to announce there will be special deals on Referral Candidate and Pricing. You'll be able to claim these promotions if you stay with us until the end of the webinar. We'll tell you how you can claim them. All right. Okay, let's get into details now. Borg, they're all yours. I'm going to let you share your screen.
Okay, cool. So I was actually telling that I am planning to go through this agenda today. So I will basically initially start with the idea of the webinar. So I really want all of us to be on the same page regarding e-commerce pricing. So I really want to be sure that you guys are actually aware of the importance of pricing in e-commerce. And as we become aware, as we actually get to the same page regarding e-commerce pricing, I will be going through the major e-commerce pricing strategies, methods applied by our customers, or actually all sizes of e-commerce companies from all around the world. And then basically I will be melting down these e-commerce pricing strategies into a pot, which we call smart competitive pricing. So smart competitive pricing basically consists of all types of pricing strategies, and it really aims to deliver you the ultimate competitive power in any market that you are existing. So let me start with a basic question. So let me start with something provocative, actually. So is price really everything in e-commerce? So this is actually a question that we don't like that often as an e-commerce player. So we don't really want to focus on pricing that much, because we believe that our customer support is great. We actually really try to satisfy our customers in many different ways, but at the end of the day, price is really crucial, guys. So here I will be actually going through three interesting statistics that really signifies the importance of pricing. So the initial number is actually 90%, and guys, you should know that 90% of your potential customers, so online shoppers, really compare online product prices across shops for, you know, not less than 10 minutes on average. So it's really the huge majority of online retailers that are really price sensitive. So they really dedicate a certain amount of their like online shopping time into benchmarking your prices versus your competition. So you should also better put yourself into their shoes. So you should also put some time on thinking about the right pricing strategies in your e-commerce store. The other number is 60%, and 60% of online shoppers also really explicitly state that pricing is their most important criteria affecting their, you know, purchase decisions. So they really think that pricing comes first, and then all the other stuff comes secondary or third and stuff. So 60% of your shoppers have this mentality in their mind. And more result-oriented statistic is this one, actually. So 20% of our online traffic actually of e-commerce sites traffic is actually already coming from price comparison engines. This is an average number, of course. So if you guys are, for example, in Google Shopping or all other similar price comparison engines active in your country, about 25, maybe 15 to 20% of your traffic is already coming from a landscape where you are simply only compared, only benchmark on price. So these three statistics really put the importance of pricing, I think, into the right perspective. So after kind of making sure that pricing is really important for our success, I can now drill down into the pricing methods that I would like to go through in this webinar. And the initial method will be the most simplistic one. Actually, it's cost-based pricing. Then market-oriented pricing will come, and then consumer-oriented pricing will come. And as a kind of bonus, I will be going through a few psychological pricing tips. So let me start with cost-based pricing strategy. So here, you know, when we think of cost-based pricing, we mostly actually remember our days maybe coming from economics 101. So it's actually microeconomics where we have a certain cost for a product, and you should have a target profit margin. When you just add this into a sum, we get our price eventually. So this is the most simplistic perspective in cost-based pricing. So you have a cost, you have a target profit margin, then voila, you have your price. But here, the biggest actually mistake in e-commerce is really oversimplifying the thought of the cost. So here, we oftentimes consider the cost only as the cost that we pay to our suppliers as unit purchasing price. But actually, we should be definitely overheading all our marketing costs, operational costs, so not the costs that are not really easily calculated at product level should be also overheaded into the product cost. Then we should be aiming for the target profit margin. So in the cost-based pricing, we should not be miscalculating the cost. So we should be also overheading all different types of costs into a unit product cost. Then we should be aiming for the profit margin. And then the tricky part with the cost-based pricing strategy is that it's, you know, it's actually a trade-off. So you can simply isolate yourself from the market. You can have your cost coming from your suppliers, all other operational costs, and then you might, you know, put the price tags into the market. But then, unless you really benchmark yourself versus competition, you might sometimes be actually undervaluing your product. So let's say you have a really big cost advantage at a certain brand, and you just calculated a certain profit margin, and without checking the market, you just came up with a really low price tag. So in these cases, actually, you might be really undervaluing your products. And the other way is actually also losing your competitiveness. So applying the cost-based pricing strategy alone can really kill your business. So you can either apply this cost mentality in a wrong way, so you can miscalculate your cost, or unless you really also check out the market prices, you can either undervalue or, you know, really inflate your prices and lose your competitiveness. So cost-based pricing is actually a notion that you should really keep in your mind, but you shouldn't be applying this alone. So which brings us to the second excellent strategy that I will go through, and it's market-oriented pricing. So are you going to say something, Ro? Yeah.
We have a couple questions about this first part. I don't know if you want to address them now. We can move into...
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So... So there's a question from the Dimitris that so you had a metric that was 60%. I believe it was at the beginning of the webinar, one of the first few slides. And he was asking if that metric that you were sharing was also for B2B e-commerce.
Yeah, I think, you know, I don't have an exact statistic for this, Dimitris, but what I see from the B2B e-commerce market, it's way more price sensitive, because at the end of the day, that's really showing the cost side of things. So, you know, B2B e-commerce is mainly cost driven. So you get the best price and then you put the products into your B2C e-commerce sites and you aim for a profit margin. So I can say that I think it's, 60% minimum for the B2B e-commerce market. So I think B2B e-commerce shoppers are way more price sensitive than their B2C counterparts. So I think it's even like 60%, 70%, 75%. I can't give an exact number, but that's what I think, to be honest.
Okay. Yeah. And also we had a similar question kind of like on the same line, when you were talking about, cost-based pricing, Amy was asking, she said that I will assume this is direct to consumer.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's a good, correct assumption. Exactly.
Sounds good.
I think I can also see the question. So I think it will be good if you can really interrupt me anytime you want, Raul. And if I will really appreciate the audience to be just shooting out their questions and they can interrupt me anytime. That's why we are actually doing this live. And that's why we kind of took the risk of, having the webinar at the beginning. Let's at least expect it to pay off, right? So, I will proceed from where I left. So I basically mentioned the cost-based pricing and I was just moving into the more detailed part, which is the market-oriented pricing. So in the market, obviously, we are never alone. So depending on our market vertical, we always have some competition in the market. And competition means, different level of offers coming from different types of online retailers. So all retailers are not really the same price all the time, not even all the time. They are never the same price in general. So we should be definitely positioning ourselves versus the market prices, because otherwise, as I just pointed out in the previous slide, we can be undervaluing ourselves or we can be losing our competitive. So we should be trying to find our sweet spot. And to do this manually is actually a real hassle, to be honest, because if you consider that you will have like thousands of products in your assortment and tens of competitors, you cannot really pinpoint all those price points and better position yourself manually in the market. So I just put a Swiss Army knife here, which kind of, symbolizes an automated competitor price tracking software like Pricing, which can help you to fully automate all this data gathering process so that you can really adjust and you can really set the more market-oriented pricing, price points that will both include the cost-based pricing strategies, but also the market-oriented pricing strategies. So let me move on here. So here, actually, as I mentioned at the beginning, regarding the market-oriented pricing, we should initially understand our market. So what is actually our unique selling proposition that is being delivered to the market? So are we kind of, a luxury retailer that is really delivering a value, that is really something desirable for the consumers? Or are we really delivering something that's kind of a commodity? It's really price related. So we should be understanding our unique selling proposition, because this will actually kind of put the, let's say, competitive aim into our minds. And depending on this actually mentality, depending on our unique selling proposition, we should be understanding, where we really stand alongside our competitors. So in most cases, when I actually talk to our customers or when I talk to any size of e-commerce company from all around the world, I hear that, when they hear the word competitive, they kind of have this fear of really killing their profit margins, losing all the, money that they are making tightly and stuff. But actually being competitive is not necessarily always decreasing your prices to the bottom. So it's not necessarily a race to the bottom. But on the opposite side, you can actually identify some cases where you really have cheap prices. So the cases when you can notice that you are undervaluing yourself. So if you really actually understand where you stand alongside your competitors, you can even find sweet spots to increase your prices. And this is believe me, this is one of the sweetest pricing gains that we are delivering at the moment to all our customers from all around the world. So they detect some product prices that are relatively cheaper than the market average or even the minimum of the market, so that they can increase their prices to a certain range while they will still remain the cheapest. I will go through this strategy in a while again in more detail, but again, to benchmark yourself versus competition is not necessarily always a race to the bottom, but it can even bring you some opportunities to uplift your profit margins, uplift your prices. And another market-oriented pricing aspect is actually a more niche thing called penetration pricing. So some of you guys might be new to e-commerce or might even be considering to enter into the e-commerce market. So at the beginning, if you are entering into a crowded market, you should be aiming for attracting some attention from your potential customers. So in such cases, it's also better to aim for gathering as much as market pricing information as possible, and then maybe losing a certain amount of margin at the initial stage to really consider that discount as a customer acquisition cost. So penetration pricing is actually, figuring out the market averages, aiming for a lower range than that, and then slowly increasing your profit margins after a while. So these are all different sides of market-oriented pricing. And aftermarket oriented pricing, I come to the point of consumer oriented pricing. So this is somewhat similar. This is somewhat in the range of actually market oriented pricing, because the market itself is actually where the consumers live. So again, here we should be asking more customer oriented questions to ourselves while doing our business. So we should once again figure out what is our unique selling proposition, what kind of customers we are dealing with. So are they really price sensitive, or are they really looking for premium service, premium products? And here we should be really figuring out a single thing. So we should really find out whether it's black or white. So it's like a customer type willing to pay a premium for our service, for our product, or a customer type that is really a deal hunter. So they can really have almost zero loyalty when they notice a lower price at a competitor, or if they are actually paying a premium for my product that cannot be really benchmark versus another site. Maybe I'm a jewelry maker, you know, it's a really custom made jewelry, and you cannot really compare this to another product in the market. So in such cases, we should be actually defining our target profit margin. So obviously, in the case of the jewelry thing, so we should be aiming for higher profit margins, because we won't be really benchmark versus the competition. But in case of the deal hunters, let's say in case of a market where we are selling the exact same stuff, where we also have like tons of different options, we should be aiming for obviously lower profit margins, and we should be aware that these are the consumers that are that we are dealing with. And the consumer-oriented pricing has actually, you know, triggered a lot of discussion around, you know, purchasing psychology and all this type of exciting stuff that I will go through. And this also brings us to a question in the psychology behind the purchasing decision. And I believe that this is actually my belief. If pricing is actually a science, you know, it's not necessarily only economics, but it's really also psychology. So it's something in between. So it's both psychology and economics. And this will also bring us to the subject of psychological pricing. So I just basically mentioned to you cost-based pricing, market-oriented pricing, and consumer-oriented pricing. And this psychological pricing aspect is actually the extension of consumer-oriented pricing. And here I will be basically going through a few scientific theories that have actually, you know, published papers behind them. So I will not, of course, give you all the details of the, you know, scientific papers that are behind these theories. But if you guys are interested, please feel free to send me an email after this webinar, or send an email to Raul, and I can totally supply all relevant scientific sources. So I'm not this type of guy that is kind of killing all the references, just talking about the stuff, whether, you know, as if it's his own proof or something. I really rely on scientific research, and I can totally share what I have at the background. So feel free to ask me the resources of this material. So the first psychological pricing theory is actually maybe a little too elementary. So we all know what it is, and it's actually called charm pricing. And it's actually the beauty of nines at the end of the price point. So here we have got actually really basic question of finding out which price tag is going to sell more. And obviously, we are all used to the nines at the end of the price point. So the right answer is, of course, the 19.99. But I noticed that, you know, in many, many e-commerce sites that can actually apply this strategy, this theory is still not applied. So in most of the webinars or most of the talks that I'm going through all these strategies, I ask the audience a single thing. So if you will take only a single strategy out of this, you know, 30, 40 minutes of webinar, just go back to your web shop and figure out whether you are applying charm pricing or not. And if you are not applying, just apply this tonight or this afternoon or whatever time you have ahead of your calendar. So just make sure that you're applying charm pricing. I really cannot understand why companies are not doing this that often. You know, when they have the potential, they can do this really easily, but still they are not doing it. So the first theory is the most simplest one, and it's called charm pricing. And you should totally be doing it now. The second theory that I will go through is actually somewhere, you know, around charm pricing. So it's called rational pricing. Here we actually have a psychology behind the certain type of product that we are retailing. So here the scientific research tells us that the psychology behind the purchasing decision is also affected by the type of the product associated with the decision. So here I'm giving an example of a like HP desktop computer. And let's assume that we are all going to shop this product from a certain price tag. So the theory says that we are going to be a quite ratio-driven. So we will be really, really rational while doing this purchase because we will be going through all the specs of this product, gigabytes, you know, all the RAMs and stuff. So we will be really drilling down all the data points in the product specification page for this purchase decision. So we, most of the time, also expect the price tag to be similarly calculated. So we, most of the time, actually more often, convert better for the price tag that looks like calculated. So this is also scientifically proven, guys. So for this product, for example, the A price tag works better because it's not really ending with zeros, but it's looking like something calculated. It's 375.18. And we, you know, it really puts the price tag in line with all the product specifications and stuff. So this can be applied at web shops that are selling products that are mostly purchased by rational people. So I mean, not rational people, but by the people that are really buying products and spending time on the, you know, type of the product, its specifications and all the stuff. And on the contrary, we have something called emotional pricing. And I think you can imagine where this is heading to. So for emotional pricing, this time we have some like basic products, not basic products, but emotional products. So let's look at this really, really nice, sweet pillow with a nice, you know, bird icon on it. So here, if you are someone really checking out this product in a nice web shop, you are not really reading all details of its texture, all, you know, where it's made in, you know, its colors and stuff, RAL codes, you know, Pantone colors. You are not really doing a scientific research on the product specifications, but you just liked how it looks like. You can imagine that you can be, you know, putting it in your couch. You can be just napping next week during you know, after a long work day and stuff. So these are mostly emotional thoughts that are really irrelevant in the first case. So in the HP desktop computer case. So the scientific research tells us that for this type of emotional pricing, emotional products, you should be applying the most simplistic price points available. So you can think that this is actually conflicting with the idea of charm pricing. Actually, that was why I mentioned that you should be applying charm pricing when it's applicable. So if you are actually a retailer selling this pillow type of products, you shouldn't be really aiming for the charm pricing. But if you are a retailer, you know, selling mostly ration-driven products, you should totally aim for either rational pricing or charm pricing.
Burke, actually, yeah. I have a question. I think I'm jumping in at the perfect moment. We have a question from Amy. She was asking if charm pricing will apply to upscale products, and you just explained that charm pricing would not apply, or actually would not apply for products, you know, kind of like people are buying in a more emotional and not really rational way. So will be another example of this upscale products, an example of when not to use or to use charm pricing.
I think, you know, in case of upscale actually products, we should go back to the consumer oriented pricing approach. So it's actually telling us that our consumers are not really deal hunters. So if we are selling an upscale product, you know, the guys are not really into the $5 of discount and stuff, but they are really right into the product. So they should be making sure that they will get the product safe, they will get a good quality product. So obviously price will come like secondary or third. So I think it's more similar to the emotional pricing rather than rational pricing, because we already convinced, we, you know, in case of upscale products like jewelry, I don't know, unique products and stuff, I think we are mainly dealing with the emotions of our consumers rather than their brains. So I would assume that these emotional price points will work better, in case of upscale products. So my answer is actually no, Amy. So I think charm pricing won't really apply to upscale products because it's not really that necessary to apply charm pricing. Yeah.
And I saw, if you're selling a high-end product, right? If you're selling a high-end product, you want to present it as a bargain.
Yeah. You should make sure that your customers will really get this upscale product safe and they will get a good quality product. That's the priority in such a market. And if you are in that type of market, Amy, I think you are quite lucky because you get, let's say fat profit margins, hopefully. And, you know, you are not really the majority that is really trying to be as competitive as possible, you know, losing a bit of profit margins due to competition and stuff. So I'm happy for you. Yeah. I also see a question from Sam. So if you guys don't mind, I can also jump into that question, as we just heard.
Sure.
So we sell, I'm just reading the question of Sam, guys. So Sam is asking that they are selling car parts. They have 10,000 SKUs in their inventory. So can we mix these theories across the range? And I totally think that you can, Sam, because I think the car parts industry is more similar to the HP desktop markets than this, you know, nice little pillow that we all look at the moment. So I think you can mostly apply churn pricing, rational pricing strategies. But I think what you can get most out of this webinar is mainly at the end of the webinar, which is the smart competitive pricing. So mostly, you know, when I go through these pricing strategies, people can think that these are actually mutually exclusive strategies. So you should be picking the cost-based pricing strategy or market-oriented pricing strategy, but that's not actually true. So these are actually all bullets that you should be actually putting into your marketing weapon. So they're actually all kind of puzzling into themselves. So they really make a good strategy in your bag. So you should be totally mixing these theories and strategies altogether. But in regards with this white and black analogy, I think I would put you into the deal hunters market, where you will be facing a lot of price competition from your, you know, competition eventually. And in that case, I would mainly go for churn pricing. I would mainly go for rational pricing, and I will also go for smart competitive pricing. That will be that we will be just going through in a while. Yeah, I hope this answers your question, Sam. So let me proceed, guys. So we were just going through this nice little pillow once again. So I just mentioned that in emotional pricing case, we should be aiming for foolproof prices, like $62. It's easy, just add to cart, and you don't really need to deal with the currencies and all these detailed price points and stuff. The third theory is actually, let's say, another. The third and fourth theory are not really that straightforward. So expect some surprise here, guys. So the third theory says that if we use smaller fonts, actually in our price tags, somehow, like really, again, this is also scientific, by the way. So it somehow convinces the customers that this price is actually literally smaller. So they can really be convinced that the price tag is actually showing the same figure, but it's still less. So in this case, using smaller price tags, smaller font price tags, is actually converting better, even if we apply the same price point. So you guys can actually also go back to your web shop, check out your front end, maybe play with the font sizes and stuff. And I believe this can also yield a certain return in a short amount of time, especially if you are really doing the opposite. So I cannot really guarantee that you will get some results if you just, decrease the font size from, let's say, 30 to 28. But if you are really using huge fonts, as you have just thought that, okay, huge fonts might be more, striking, so this might convert customers better, this is actually wrong. So you should be actually decreasing the font sizes in your web shop, and I think you can get better results. And this actually strategy is getting even more powerful if you apply really huge anchor prices next to them. So if you use, for example, for this price point, if you use something like 59.99 in a huge price font, and if you put a strike through on it by saying that, okay, this was 59.99 yesterday, but now we just discounted it to a really small price that you see over here. So this contrast is also kind of making the consumers to feel that the discount is really huge because of the size of the font. So this is also an interesting paper that I just read a while ago. So I can totally share the details of it as well, like I said at the beginning of all these theories. The fourth strategy, the theory, is actually the most controversial, I would say, but it also has, again, it also has scientific background, scientific research behind it. And here we are actually dealing with syllables. So we have got same sizes of fonts, similar price ranges and stuff, but here we are now talking about syllables. So when you think about syllables, you should be asking yourself whether we are really reading something out loud while doing online shopping by our computer, by our iPad or stuff. Obviously we are doing this, we are not doing this, but somehow I think in our minds, we are still reading the price tags. So if you read, for example, price tag A here, it's 27.82, and the second one is 28.16. So as you have just noticed, the B price tag has less syllables in it. So somehow our minds read it faster because it's shorter. And in the experiment, it was also proven that a shorter price tag in terms of syllables is actually converting better. So this is, I think, the most controversial, I would say, psychological pricing theory that I just wanted to explain. So as I promised, all these theories actually are not mutually exclusive, guys. So they can actually all be mixed up into the right strategy, right strategic point that you can actually aim for in the market. And we call this smart competitive pricing. So in smart competitive pricing, we basically take cost-based pricing, apply consumer-oriented pricing on top of it, and we always look for the market competition. And then we also come up with certain actionable pricing strategies. So I will be going through some pricing strategies that you can take down notes and apply in your web shop, you know, starting from today or tomorrow. So in these strategies, actually the first one is remaining both competitive and profitable. So this is not really that actionable, but this is actually killing a dangerous action. So it's, you know, not doing something is also, I think, a strategy. That's at least what I have seen in my pricing career. So most of the time companies notice that they are, you know, relatively higher than their competition. So they can see that they are having at least like $30 difference from the market minimum. So they always think for, you know, cutting down their price, $40 to be the minimum. But here we should be totally selective on discount opportunities. So we shouldn't be always, for example, for this product. So this is a screenshot from our dashboard. So here you see a certain product. It's a Thermos. It's actually a Stelton brand. But anyways, we got this price point, 67.04. at the bottom. So this is our price. It's our current price from the market. And we have all these seven competitors lower than us. So when you, for example, take a look at this price point, your first reflex, your first action shouldn't be always aiming for $35. So you should be initially understanding that pricing is actually a team sport. So it also has a defense side. So you should be also going back to your actually purchasing team, discussing this situation with them, and aiming for cutting down your product costs, and then actually trying to find a lower price point. So this position shouldn't be always, you know, taking you into the position of discounting or, you know, giving promotions and stuff. So we should be always remaining profitable while still remaining competitive. So this is also one of the fears of retailers when they hear competitive pricing. So they think that they will be losing all their profit margins. They will be making losses because of competition. But we also emphasize that they should be also taking care of their costs internally by negotiating better with their suppliers, which I will go through in a while. So the second mentality, let's say, second strategy is actually something that I have explained earlier. So it's actually identifying price increase opportunities. So again, in competitive pricing, you don't necessarily need to discount all the time, but you can actually maybe notice some products where you have cost advantage, a price increase opportunity. So you can detect that here, for example, you can detect that you have the cheapest price in the market thanks to this great supplier relationship you have with Bach, for example. Bach is actually a nice musical equipment brand from, I think, UK. So let's say you are supplying Bach products at a relatively cheaper price point than your competition. So when you apply cost-based pricing strategy, you come up with this price point of 35.93. But this price can be really cheaper than the market minimum if you don't look at the competition. And if you just stay at this position, you will be losing money that you could have won otherwise. So if you made your price points, for example, 39, so instead of 35.93, if you increase your price point to 39.93 by gathering the right amount of competitive pricing intelligence, you can make actually $4 out of every single sale that you will be making almost at the same sales volume. Because here, your consumers will be already benchmarking your price versus your competition. So here in this case, they will be aiming for you because you are the cheapest. But here, they will think the same. So they will be still buying the same amount of product from you, almost same, of course, but almost same amount of product from your web shop. But they will be paying $4 each more. So you will be getting this $4 as a profit, as a hard cash profit, thanks to smart competitive pricing. The other part is actually also related to pricing from a secondary level, let's say. So it's not necessarily only about price points, but it's actually about stock availabilities. So actually the stock availability is quite similar to price points, because if a product is not in stock, the price does not actually exist. So consumers cannot really take an act, actually add a product into their cart if the stock is not actually there. So even if you got the right profit, the right price point, if you don't have the product in stock, you don't really have that price actually. So this is also same for your competition. So even if they have this cost advantage, so even if they have this right price to convince the customer better than you, if they are out of stock, you can actually take the market from their hands. So the biggest profit margin lift opportunity also arises in such a case. So when a highly demanded product in your assortment, for example, a really nice consumer electronics product that is catching a hype and it's actually out of stock at your competitors. Like in this case, for example, let's say we have the sweet case and actually we have the best price in the market. Okay, but our competition also has higher prices, but they are actually out of stock. So in this case, we can actually increase our prices. So we don't really need to stay 86.12 because the really consumers don't have another chance to buy this product from our webshop. So we can even further increase our price points like the previous example, and we can still be the best option in the market, and we can make more dollars out of every single sale that we will make. So stock availability, as I just stated here, is also part of the competitive game. It's also part of the smart competitive e-commerce strategy. So the other actually secondary, let's say, other peripheral strategy is also regarding your marketing budget. So if you really play the smart competitive pricing game in actually a smart way, you can also spend your marketing budget smarter. So I mean, if you are actually, let's say you have two types of products, okay? Actually, you have two products. One is actually the cheapest in the market. It has the most attractive prices in the market. And the other one is actually not the same. So it's even, more than the market average. So you are paying the same CPC money for these two products and you are generating the same amount of traffic. If you are doing the load balancing, let's say, for the budget on the two products at the same level, you will notice that the cheaper price product is actually converting way better. So it's making actually more return on investment rather than the actually expensive product. So you can actually adjust this load balancing towards the more competitive price point product. So you can actually adjust your marketing budget towards more actually competitive products. So instead of wasting click money on products that won't be converting anyways, you can actually spend this extra dollar into a product that you can make sure that it will be converting. So you can spend your marketing budget smarter. And the other thing is actually more related with the analysis. So it's not necessarily only about today. So you competitive pricing is quite dynamic. So you should be always checking out your competition all the time during the day. And it's actually something live, because the e-commerce market is actually live. It has its heartbeat and everything. But also, we should be taking a minute to see what has happened like last week, last month. And here we can also spot interesting stuff like our competitors' discounting habits. So for example, you can detect something like a competitor's particular discounts on Saturday morning from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. on this particular brand. So when you detect this type of strategies from your competitor's agenda, you can actually counteract, you can act accordingly, and you can even kill their competitive game. So you can actually beat that campaign by applying another campaign. So you can actually analyze and take action on top of historical pricing trends. So you can see something like, for example, this competitor, one of your competitors have, Joseph is actually another brand, another home brand. So let's say that you have just noticed that Amazon decreased its price on 24th of May last year on this particular brand. So you can say that, okay, maybe they have got a cheaper product price from Joseph. So you can analyze the historical prices as well. So you can take action for today or actually for tomorrow. This is also part of the smart competitive pricing game. And another layer is actually the cost side of things. So it's, again, I think you already get my point about being competitive, right? So I'm not really trying to say you that you should be checking out your competitor prices and then you should be beating them all the time. It's not necessarily that. Of course, it will be including that to a certain level, but it's also about the other aspects around competitive pricing strategies. So this negotiation with the suppliers is actually regarding the cost side of things. So if you, for example, see things like a brand is actually retailing way below the market average at a certain competitor, you can notice that this brand supplier is actually supplying that product at a lower rate than they are doing this for you. So you can sit down with the supplier, show the data to them and tell them that you are aware of this discount being offered to your competitor, and you can ask the same thing. So you can also get the same cost advantage. So you can actually, if you have the cost advantage, you can still apply the same profit margin, but you can get a more competitive price at the end of the day. So you can apply, again, you can apply all these different types of smart competitive pricing strategies. And believe me, I am hearing interesting other strategies being applied by our customers, because we are also luckily working with smart e-commerce retailers from all around the world. And I have been presenting this type of webinars for about 1.5 years. So I think 50% of the content is actually coming from customer feedback. So I'm hearing that they're applying this and that. So if you guys have the chance, if you guys can catch the chance of hearing my webinar, for example, 6 months from now, I think I will be also delivering something fresh. And to actually close actually my bit of webinar, I would also once again like to tell that you can be always asking the scientific research behind what I have just gone through. So don't consider that this is actually just a marketing buzzword and stuff. So it's really scientific, guys. So you can really apply all the strategies that I mentioned here, and you can really expect a solid return on investment out of all these strategies. So thanks a lot for listening to me, or actually watching me today. So as I actually didn't have the chance to mention at the beginning, I am actually an e-commerce lover, like all of you guys listening to me. So I'm more interested in the pricing aspect, but I really like all sides of e-commerce companies from all around the world. I like to discuss any aspect of e-commerce, not just pricing. I like to discuss any aspect of pricing, and I try to do this type of presentations, blog posts, and anything like that around pricing, around e-commerce all the time. So you might be actually seeing my face or reading my blog post in the next blog post that you will be reading. So regarding our software, please visit our website after this webinar. It's pricing.com, and feel free to try it and test it for 14 days now and try to apply the strategies that I went through during this webinar. And for any further questions, please feel free to email me at burch@pricing.com. Thanks a lot for listening. And I think now, Raul, we will have this nice questions from the audience, right?
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for your time. We've learned a lot from you today. We actually have a few questions, but before we go into those, explain what we mentioned at the beginning. Let me see real quick. All right, so. So as I mentioned, we have several deals that you can apply both on Referral Candy and pricing today. So since you stayed until the end of the webinar with us, let me tell you more about this. All right, so if you're thinking about running a referral program on your online store, you can get started on Referral Candy, and you can actually get $50 off when you sign up on Referral Candy, when you sign up on a new account. Just to give you, if you're not familiar with Referral Candy, where pricing starts at $49 a month after a 30-day free trial. So if you get this discount, you're basically getting a two-month free trial. So all you have to do is email me. There's my email right there. So that's raulg@referralcandy.com. So again, that's raulg@referralcandy.com. You can just email me and say something nice like, hey, we love the webinar and we'll love to get the discount. Here's the account that you just signed up on Referral Candy. And also for pricing, you can also get a 50% discount on your first month. And all you have to do is email Burk. So that's burc@pricing.com. Again, that's burc@pricing.com. And you can claim your discount there. So now we're going to go with the questions. So actually, Burk, feel free to get started with the questions and answer them, because I'm pretty sure they're all going for you.
Yeah, and first of all, let me start with actually let me do a follow on Sam's question. I can totally now understand your point about classic Mercedes parts. So if they are really that emotional, you can understand my perspective from emotional side of things. So if you are really doing something almost upscale or something kind of unique for your consumers, then you can actually ignore charm price and you can really try to apply a more simplistic pricing approach and more focus on your assortment, more focus on your images in your website, and then you can actually decrease the weight of your price points in the product detail page. So sorry for understanding you wrong at the beginning. So if it's really classic Mercedes parts, which I'm also very fond of, I think it's really emotional. I totally agree. And Amy has just asked something about the color of the font. So actually, as you have noticed, I didn't really go through the details of the font color in this presentation. But I have also read some interesting stuff about that, and I was actually thinking of adding some material into that. So if you like, you can also email me, and I can actually send you the stuff that I have read about the color of the font. So I didn't include something into the webinar, but make sure that there are also some scientific backgrounds for the color choices. It's like green, blue, what do they mean and everything. So I can totally share some material about that as well. And Femi's question is actually also something common. I also hear this quite often. So he's asking, he's asking something about the private label products. So in case of private label products, we totally depend on our customers. So if they would like to benchmark their product versus a certain product, they have the full control of doing this. So let's say you have this product A and you see this product X at a competitor as your competing product, as your substitute product. You basically add that product as a competitor of product A versus your own website, and then you are then able to benchmark the prices of competition. So you have kind of the full control in drawing the competitive landscape in our software. So it's also working for private label products. So we have some customers from different parts of the world that are using pricing for that need. And Alan's question is actually taking me back to the presentation, I guess, but Alan, is it the first pricing strategy or first, I say, smart competitive pricing strategy? Because I went through, to recap, actually, I went through cost-based pricing, I went through market-oriented pricing, then I explained consumer-oriented pricing, and then I went through a few psychological pricing theories, starting with charm pricing, like easily using nines at the end of price points, and then I mentioned rational and emotional pricing. And then I went through less syllables, smaller fonts. And in my case, it was actually this strategy, but I think I don't need to share my screen again, but I mentioned that if you really want to be competitive, you should be closely working with your purchasing team as well. So it's not actually always checking out competitor prices and discounting accordingly, but when you notice that you have a high price in the market, your first reflex, your first reaction shouldn't be discounting. It should be going next to these purchasing guys, sitting down with them and analyzing the situation, trying out for ways to decrease your unit product cost for that product. If you succeed on that, then you can still apply the same profit because we are actually doing this business for becoming profitable, right? So applying the same profit margin and then getting a different discounted price point. So this was the competitive strategy that I explained at the beginning, Alan. Sam, feel free to email me. And Raul has just explained the discounts and promos that we have given. You can just email me or Raul. Hey, Raul, sorry, by the way, I'm just stealing your show, but I kind of felt like a moderator, but I'm just reading.
Yeah. No, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I just want to make sure that people can see, but yeah. Because I feel like my screen share was also not working at the end of the webinar. So, I just want to make sure that everyone can see the two messages that I just put in the chat box. So, if you can, with our email addresses, So if you can see them, if you can type yes real quick, that would be great, just to make sure that all of you got it. You can also email us asking any question about this, if there's any pending question, or if you want to go back to the replay and you have any questions that might come up, feel free to email us and we'll be happy to answer them.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, and Amy, here is my email, by the way. I think you just saw that later on. So it's It's as Raul already wrote down, it's BURC at our company, pricing.com. Thank you, Dimitris.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you guys for being here. Burke, I think we're going to leave it here. Thank you so much for all your explanations today. We learned a lot, me included. I learned a lot during the webinar. So again, I want to appreciate your time. And yeah, absolutely. And to everyone here, thank you so much. And we'll see you next time.
Yeah, ciao, ciao. Bye-bye. Thank you, guys.
Bye-bye.